Hi, very good morning. I'm Dr. Janak Patel. I'm an MD general physician. Today we'll be talking on one of the ideally a short topic very frequently asked to you in your theory. And once in a while you will come across this group of people in your everyday practice, that is cardiorenal syndrome. It is asked as a short note in your theory part. So cardiorenal syndrome, or short form, it is called as a CRS. Now there is one another terminology, it is called CRAS, that is cardiorenal anemia syndrome. So now here, cardiac condition leading to renal involvement, or there are some, that is 3 and 4, are renal which produces cardiac involvement. So, but still the word utilized is cardiorenal. We don't call renocardiac syndrome. So these two are very closely related. So we'll be discussing on introduction, type, pathophysiology, in general treatment and complications. So CRS is generally defined as a pathophysiological disorder of heart and kidney, whereby acute or chronic dysfunction of one organ may induce acute or chronic dysfunction of another organ. So whether cardiac produces involvement of the heart, produces involvement of the kidney, or involvement of kidney producing involvement of the heart. So that is in general termed as CRS, or we call cardiorenal syndrome. By and large, when we say CRS, meaning kidney dysfunction due to diseased heart, assuming that in presence of healthy heart, same kidney would function normally. A simple most definition. So if heart was normal, kidney would not have got involved. But because of heart involvement or cardiac involvement, the kidney gets dysfunction depending upon the onset of cardiac involvement. And that we call as a cardiorenal syndrome. So we can call that as cardiorenal or renocardia. Now suppose if there is a primary involvement of the kidney and secondary to kidney, now I get involvement of the heart, then we call a renocardiac syndrome. It may be acute or it may be chronic. Now, who came first, egg or a hen, you will have to decide. And that is based by a good clinical history. So basically it is divided into 5 groups. CRF type 1, where the usual term utilized is acute cardiorenal, meaning acute congestive heart failure leading to renal involvement. Type 2 is a chronic cardiac disorder, so chronic congestive heart failure leading to kidney involvement. By and large in acute, it will produce AKI. By and large in chronic, it will produce chronic kidney disease. Now, if there is an acute renal involvement, so AKI producing cardiac involvement and CKD producing cardiac involvement. So that is 3 and 4. But fifth is secondary to some other conditions other than heart and kidney. Say as for example, diabetes, hypertension, malignancy, etc. involves heart and kidney. By and large, we say terminal disorders involving heart and kidney. Then we call that as a secondary or type 5 variety, secondary cardiorenal syndrome. So these are the 5 categories which are being divided: type 1, type 2, type 3, type 4, and type 5. So CRS is bidirectional. Chronic can be there existing, and on the top of that you get acute onset. and acute can go into chronic. So by and large we say that cardiorenal or renocardiac, and acute usually goes into chronic, or on the top of a chronic you get an acute involvement. So this is a bidirectionally, and there is a time window. So you have to decide whether what is acute, what is chronic. And now there was in 2010, they introduced one more term, that is CRAS, which is a pathological process involving progressive deterioration of heart and kidney. And it become worse in presence of anemia. At that, it was called as a cardiorenal anemia syndrome. Combination of heart failure, kidney failure, and anemia. So cardiac, renal, and anemia think together. So any degree of heart failure, any degree of kidney failure, and any degree of anemia together, we call that as CRAS. That is the term which is being utilized. Now, etiology-wise, we already told you in type 1, basically it is a cardiac involvement involving kidney. Type 2, chronic cardiac disease, say like chronic congestive heart failure producing chronic kidney disease. While in type 1, it is acute congestive heart failure producing AKI. Type 3, AKI producing cardiac involvement like congestive heart failure, arrhythmias, or ischemia. Chronic kidney disease, CKD, producing involvement of the heart, say like hypertrophy, cardiomyopathy, cardiac arrhythmias, congestive heart failure, etc. And type 5, systemic condition like diabetes, sepsis, malignancy, and SYNTO, both cardiac and renal involvement. One of the common word we usually sometimes use the word MODES. So that will be labeled as secondary cardiorenal syndrome or type 5 variety. Now all these particular things, they are interrelated, and one of the precipitating factor is anemia. Now older age, comorbid conditions like diabetes, uncontrolled hypertension, and anemia stands topmost on the list, and they are the highest risk factor for cardiorenal syndrome. Now there are some drugs which can precipitate cardiorenal syndrome, like anti-inflammatory drugs we call NSAID, steroids, diuretics, particularly loop diuretics, thiazide diuretics, angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors, and sometimes combination of angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitor with angiotensin receptor blockers. So those becomes a common, and aldosterone receptor antagonists can be also one of the cause for cardiorenal syndrome. As far as heart is concerned, previous heart failure, impaired left ventricular dysfunction, prior history of myocardial infarction, elevated cardiac troponin, etc. becomes a risk factors, which predisposes to heart failure. While in a chronic kidney disease, reduced GFR, elevated blood urea creatinine, and also elevated level of cystine also are predisposing factor or risk factors. So age, very important. CV mortality is much more higher in an end stage renal disease. One third of a mild impairment of a renal function will produce quite frequently secondary due to overt cardiovascular disease. Now if we go to the pathophysiology, it is a vicious cycle. One organ fails, it will involve the second organ. But say as we are discussing regarding a cardiorenal, we have to talk regarding a cardiac, and we have to talk regarding a kidney. So there are some of the factors which will be involved in cardiac involvement which can involve kidney. Say like RAS system, increased sympathetic activity, oxygen reactive oxygen species, endothelial dysfunction, BNP, inflammatory mediators, arginine vasopressin effects, etc. We'll be going through one by one. These are some of the, we call as a biomarkers, or some of the molecules which are responsible for involvement of the kidney. Like NGAL, called as a neutrophil, gelatinase associated lipocalin, cystein C, kidney injury molecule 1, N-acetyl beta D glucosamine deaminase, glucosamine iodase, natrin 1, sodium hydrogen exchanger, that is NHE, glutathione S transferase, then L-type fatty acid binding protein, interleukin 6, interleukin 8, and interleukin 18. These are all the different molecules which can be involved in kidney dysfunctions. Now, in type 1 variety, acute congestive heart failure, or we also called as acute decompensated heart failure, acute coronary syndrome, or iodine contrast procedures done for, say, coronary angiography, or a person is undergoing CABG, or person is undergoing, say, angioplasty. Now, during that particular period, either because of iodine contrast or because of congestive heart failure, what happens? These are all the pathophysiology which takes place. Hemodynamically, there is a damage because of fall of blood pressure, increased central venous pressure, renal venous congestion. There are exogenous factors like contrast media or diuretics which are used during the procedures. Or there is a hormonal mechanism which gets activated, like RAS system and sympathetic nervous system activation. Or there is a release of natriuretic peptides like BNP, ANP, and it produces natriuresis. There is systematic oxidative stress, where there is a labile ion generation reactive oxygen species, which will lead to cytokine activation and apoptosis. All this mechanism, there are multiple factors. You can see there are multiple factors. So these are secondary due to acute cardiac event. Particularly, the most common is acute decompensated heart failure. And these are other conditions which can also precipitate cardiac disease producing acute kidney injury. There is a decreased oxygen delivery. There will be hypoxia. Secondary to that, you will have a decreased GFR because of renal vasoconstriction, necrosis, apoptosis, and there will be resistance to ANP and BNP. And because of resistance, there will be no natriuresis. There will be retention of sodium and water, and this will lead to acute kidney injury, or we call as AKI. This is typical in what we call as type 1 variety of cardiorenal syndrome. Same thing is explained here. These are all the mechanism what has been explained. What are the factors? Decreased cardiac output, drugs like ACE inhibitor, diuretic, contrast media, or sympathetic activation, neurohormonal mechanism, that is RAS system activation, sodium and water retention, or BNP, which will produce natriuresis, or there is an inflammatory mediators. You will have a monocyte activation, endothelial activation, and cytokine secretions. All this will precipitate. Primary factor here is acute heart disease, particularly acute decompensated heart failure, or acute decompensated ischemic involvement during coronary angiography or during cardiac surgery. And secondary to that, you will have elevation of some biomarkers like cystatin T and GL, creatinine and KIM-1. So these biomarkers will be elevated, which will suggest that person is developing acute kidney injury. And then you will have elevation of creatinine. So this is that in detail it is being explained that because of acute decompensated heart failure, neurohormonal activation, that is plasma renin activity, increased aldosterone, increased catecholamine, increased vasopressin, increased adenosine, all this will produce what we call as a renal vasoconstriction, and that will lead to decreased renal perfusion. Secondary to decreased cardiac output because of decompensated heart failure also, and because of neurohormonal activation, also because of increased venous congestion, there is decreased cardiac output, intravascular volume is decreased, renal perfusion is decreased, and that will finally end up with what we call as a salt and water retention and AKI. And because of venous congestion increase, intra-abdominal pressure is also increased, and that will also result into decreased renal perfusion. And all that will be interrelated. So this is same slide shown to you that what are the symptom signs. So initially you will have a symptom signs of acute heart failure, and then you will have a, because of now involvement of the kidney, you will have oliguria, hypertension, puffiness of face, uremic symptoms and signs, etc. Now we go to the second group, we call it a type 2 variety. In type 2 variety, mainly the disease are cardiomyopathy, ischemic heart disease, valvular heart disease, chronic congestive heart failure, cerebrovascular disease, etc. What this does, there is a risk factors like adiposity, so obesity, diabetes mellitus, hypertension, increased oxidative stress, endothelial dysfunction, accelerated atherosclerosis, valvular calcification, all those factors. This will be producing increased susceptibility to any insult. So all these conditions will have, these risk factors will be high. And in a case of a congestive heart failure, you will have a high CVP, central venous pressure will be elevated. That will produce low cardiac output, chronic hypoperfusion of a renovascular disease or renovascular conditions. There will be increased renovascular resistance because of decreased perfusion, increased venous pressure. And secondary to that, now person will have a gradual involvement of the kidney, ischemia and damage to the kidney. Means you will have apoptosis, sclerosis, followed by fibrosis. And this will lead to what we call as a progressive chronic kidney disease. And this will be pathophysiology in case of a type 2 variety. And there will be some of the factors like anemia, sodium and water retention, uremia, calcium and phosphorus abnormality, hypertension. All this will be there secondary due to CKD. And because of chronic hypotension, apoptosis, insult, damage, sclerosis, fibrosis, and then you end up with CKD. So CKD will also produce lot of changes which will involve heart, and because of involvement of the heart, you will have a decreased cardiac output. Low cardiac output will produce endothelial dysfunction, inflammation, accelerated atherosclerosis, chronic hypoperfusion, increased renovascular resistance, increased venous pressure, embolism, etc. All those will have effect on a kidney. And kidney will produce effect on the heart. So in type 4, this will be the mechanism. So you have to remember that 3 will produce kidney injury, will now produce cardiac involvement. So basically there is an acute kidney injury, secondary due to acute glomerulonephritis, interstitial disease, that is acute tubular necrosis, tubular nephritis, pyelonephritis, acute urinary obstruction, which are the commonest etiology for AKI. What that will do? It will give rise to sodium and water retention. there will be volume expansion, hypertension, RAS system activation, sympathetic nervous system activation, and again that will have effect on heart, where it will produce hypertension, peripheral vasoconstriction, increasing in the peripheral vascular resistance. It can also induce cardiac arrhythmias, etc. Electrolyte and acid-base imbalance because of all these disorders or because of AKI itself, coagulation imbalance, labile ion release, oxidative species release, we call oxidative stress, cytokine activation, apoptosis, and you will have a damage to the myocardium. And because of that, you will have a decrease in pump, that is, ejection fraction will be reduced, cardiac arrhythmia because of electrolyte imbalance, because of hypertension, decreased supply and increased demand, acute coronary syndrome, even it can precipitate stroke. So this will be the effect of acute kidney injury on myocardium. So this is that particular same explained in little detailed way, that because of acute kidney injury, you will have a decreased GFR, hypertension, sodium and water retention, volume expansion, increased preload, and all this condition can precipitate acute heart dysfunction. Sympathetic activity can produce tachycardia, increased demand for oxygen, but no supply, ischemia, cardiac arrhythmias. RAS system activation will produce vasoconstriction, increase in blood pressure. Electrolyte, acid-base imbalance and coagulation imbalance, monocyte activation, endothelial dysfunction, cytokine activation, apoptosis, etc. will also produce a damage. And because of this, you will have a decompensation, acute heart failure, ischemic insult, arrhythmias, decreased cardiac output, and that will be what you will get effect of AKI on heart. And the biomarker wise, elevation of troponin, increase in BNP, and even a myoglobin will be elevated, etc. So troponin will be elevated, BNP will be elevated, and terminal pro-BNP will be also elevated. Even a myoglobin level, myeloperoxidase will be also elevated. So all these biomarkers will be elevated. So this is the mechanism in type 3 variety. Already we have mentioned in type 4, we have shown you a slide before. Depending upon the CKD stage, you will have acquired risk factor, genetic risk factor, and primary nephropathy, which will have effect on the heart. Anemia, uremia, calcium phosphorus abnormality, nutritional status, volume overload, etc. will also have an effect. In stage 5, when you start getting dialysis, etc., that will also produce chronic inflammation, oxidative stress, as well as it will produce EPO resistance, iron utilization. It will block hepcidin, artificial surfaces, etc. All this together will involve progressive congestive heart failure, cardiac remodeling, cardiomyopathy, LVH, increased ischemic risk, coronary and vascular calcification. There will be decreased ejection fraction, lethal cardiac arrhythmia because of electrolyte imbalance, which can occur very frequently in different stages of CKD, and reduced vascular repair. All this will be predisposing to the chronic congestive heart failure, etc. And chronic remodeling, we call as a cardiomyopathy. That will be the outcome in a case of CRS type 4 variety. So this is in detail in a CRS type 4 variety. At your leisure time you can go through, and it will also have an effect on which we call the endothelial dysfunction, bone, brain, liver, adipose tissue, pancreas, etc. All this will be there because of cytokine production, and that will also have effect on myocardium, producing remodeling, damage and remodeling. So this will be in stage 4 variety. While in stage 5, say systemic disease, critical illness, diabetes mellitus, hypertension, uncontrolled diabetes mellitus, uncontrolled hypertension, chronic illness, no prior CVD, no prior CKD. Now they can develop what we call as secondary to those, they can develop cardiorenal involvement, and this is because of RAS system activation, sympathetic nervous system activation, sepsis, systemic inflammation, hemodynamic changes because of hypoperfusion, ischemia, reperfusion injuries, altered metabolism because of hypoxia, catalytic ion release, oxidative stress, free hemoglobin, iodinated contrast media, antibiotics like aminoglycoside, etc., which are being used in sepsis. They can also produce a nephrotoxicity. Immunological response like cytokines, complements, etc., which can also end up with damage to kidney as well as heart. So AKI can develop a damage to the heart, and heart can develop a damage to kidney. We usually use the word MODES. So multi-organ dysfunction secondary due to this systemic illness. You can have involvement of the heart, you can have involvement of the kidney, and heart can produce further deterioration, and AKI can also produce further deterioration, and it can finally end up with even CKD. So this is what we get in a type 5 variety. So if you understood this, it is very simple. So person with diabetes, sepsis, malignancy, end stage disorders, amyloidosis, vasculitis, etc., because of all this mechanism can involve organ dysfunction, maybe cardiac, maybe heart. So renal dysfunction can further aggravate this, and cardiac dysfunction can also further worsen this systemic disease. So this becomes a vicious cycle. So that will be there in a person who is having a systemic conditions, which results into heart as well as kidney involvement, or we call multi-organ failure. So combined together, there are a lot of mechanisms which are working: fluid state, cardiac output, systemic vascular resistance, proteinuria, etc. So depending upon that, if he's too dry, means he's dehydrated, fluid status is on the negative side, treatment will be fluid replacement, stop diuretic. If he has got a volume overload like edema, high central venous pressure, so he has got edema, he has got what we call as a volume overload, peripheral edema, then in that case you will have to continue with diuretics. Particularly you use a distal tubular diuretics. If a person is having weight, means increased volume overload, but there is an increased sympathetic activity producing vasoconstriction, so there is a vascular resistance if it increases, you will have to use ACE inhibitor or nitroprusside or neseritide. So we call vasodilator you will use, have to use. If a person is having water retention with vasodilatation, peripheral vasodilatation, so there is a decrease in systemic vascular resistance, cardiac output is high, in that case you will have to stop ACE inhibitor and use vasopressor drugs and inotropes, and you might require ventricular assisted device. If there is a decreased ejection fraction, person is having a volume overload, there is a decreased cardiac output, then you will have to use inotropes, vasopressor, counter pulsation balloon, left ventricular assisted device. And if there is an intrinsic disease of a kidney, or it is a diuretic resistance, person has got a volume overload, there is no proteinuria, then in that case you will require a diuretic. Particularly, we call as a tubular diuretics or loop diuretics. and you might require even dialysis. So this will be the conditions, and depending upon that you decide what treatment you want to give. We already discussed what are the variety: type 1 acute congestive heart failure leading to AKI, type 2 chronic cardiac function disorders leading to CKD, type 3 AKI leading to acute congestive heart failure or arrhythmia or ischemia, chronic renocardiac syndrome means CKD leading to cardiac dysfunction, and secondary cardiorenal failure means systemic disease like diabetes, sepsis, etc., or chronic severe illness leading to multi-organ dysfunction involving heart and kidney. And depending upon that, we already discussed what is predisposing. So symptoms will be there of acute congestive heart failure in AKI, and secondarily you will have congestive heart failure symptoms and signs, and it will end up with AKI symptoms. So that will be the typical thing what will happen in this variety. Here person will have a chronic symptom signs of cardiac involvement like chronic congestive heart failure or chronic cardiac disorders leading to CKD symptoms and signs, while opposite of that, AKI symptoms preliminary leading to now cardiac dysfunction, CKD leading to cardiac dysfunctions, and here primary disease is present is systemic disease like uncontrolled diabetes, uncontrolled hypertension, end stage malignancy, severe sepsis, etc. And all those leads to involvement of the heart and involvement of the kidney. And that will be the five different groups, and clinical symptom signs will depend upon what group he belongs to and how severe is the effect. And secondary to that, you will have secondary events. What are the criterias? What are the biomarkers? What are the renal biomarker, cardiac biomarkers and renal biomarkers? What will be abnormal? So I'm not going into detail. At your leisure time, you can go through. Usually investigations are required for cardiac biomarkers and kidney biomarkers. These are all the different kidney biomarkers which are there, which will suggest which part of the kidney is being involved. It is given in detail. By and large, now most commonly utilized is SCHEME1 and NGAL. So these are the two common biomarkers which are being utilized. Cystin C is not commonly being utilized, but this you can take at these three: cystin C, cystatin C, SCHEME1 and NGAL or lipokalin. So these are the three common which are being utilized. In near future, we might come across some other biomarkers which may give you a very early interpretation of kidney involvement. And opposite of that, as far as the cardiac involvement is concerned, the most common biomarker is troponin, BNP and N-terminal pro-BNP. Those are the three common biomarkers which are being utilized. In near future, we might come across some other biomarker which can be utilized. So depending upon that, you will do those particular biomarker labels. So these are current biomarkers which are very commonly utilized. You can use ECHO for finding out the cardiac functions, etc. So this is roughly a current biomarker in CRS which is being in type 1 what you use. Type 1 is because of acute kidney acute heart failure leading to acute kidney injury, or acute heart failure secondary due to kidney injury. This will be the two biomarkers. This will be renal biomarker and this will be cardiac biomarkers. So you will have to estimate that. Depending upon that, you go for investigations. So in a CKD, you will do blood urea, creatinine, EGFR, cystatin C, etc., calcium, phosphorus, parathormone, urine protein, all those. While to find out a biomarker in AKI, you can go for that we already mentioned: cystatin C, SCHEME1 and NGAL or lipocalcin. as far as cardiac biomarker is concerned, troponin, myoglobin is not commonly being a costly. We add highly specific CRP. CRP can be utilized, and B natriuretic peptide or BNP and N-terminal pro-BNP. So these are all the different biomarkers which are being utilized. You can use even catalytic ion level, which is also one of the important thing in case of a kidney biomarkers. So these are all the different biomarkers which are being there in the pipelines. These are all different. At your leisure time, you can go through. These are future imaging studies which can be utilized. Whenever you suspect a person of a heart failure, how you proceed, we have already done in a chapter of a heart failure. This is management with a reduced ejection fraction, how you proceed. This is acute heart failure, how you investigate and how you proceed in that particular person. So treatment will depend upon, in CRS1, first is treatment of acute congestive heart failure and treatment of AKI. While CRS2, treatment of chronic cardiovascular disease and treatment of CKD. Type 3, treatment of AKI and treatment of cardiovascular complications. Type 4, treatment of CKD and treatment of cardiovascular complications secondary due to CKD. And in type 5, treatment of underlying cause like diabetes, hypertension, sepsis, etc. And try to control all those things so it will prevent damage to myocardium and damage to kidney. So in short, these are the different guidelines which are being given in an acute heart failure and chronic heart failure, which was published in 2012. This is what you do in a type 1, type 2, type 3, type 4 and type 5 variety management strategy, what are being given. And these are all standard treatments, what are being done. So at your leisure time, you can go through. This is a guideline which was published in 2012. So you'll have to go through that. If you are interested, you can go through in detail. This is what you do in an acute decompensated heart failure. By and large, you will have to use diuretic, aldosterone antagonist, beta blocker, vasodilator, ACE inhibitor, ultrafiltration, or we call dialysis, etc. And depending upon the complications, you will have to stop using diuretic and ACE inhibitor whenever there is a kidney involvement, and depending upon how severe is the kidney involvement, you will have to use and select diuretic, aldosterone antagonist and ACE inhibitor depending upon what is the pathophysiology and how severe the damage is. I end my lecture here. Sorry, I've taken a very long period for this. This is 5 mark short note ask in your theory, but still, in your everyday practice, and if you are practicing in an ICU, it will be very helpful. So I end my lecture here. I hope this will be helpful to you in your everyday practice.